welcome to the 2015 Do the Right Thing Challenge recognition ceremony. I think you can tell by all the magic that you see around you that we have a very special show planned for you today. You students in the audience represent just 1% of all the middle school students in Palm Beach County. Over 27,000 students participated this year in Do the Right Thing Challenge. But each of you had something very important to say about this problem. You students are the most important people in the room today. And although the highlight of today's presentation will be a live performance of selected works from your writing, the main business, and the first order of business, I might say, is recognition of you students. So if we could bring up the house lights at this point, what I'd like to do is ask all of the students in Dreyfus Hall now with the lights at half to stand up and be recognized, please, for your accomplishment as top 10 students. Please welcome to the Kravis stage the world-famous magician, Michael Kirshner. Listen, hold on to your seat, because this guy can get a little out of control, and when he does, nobody knows what's happening. But thank you, Michael.
Thank you very much. How's everybody doing? Welcome to the beautiful Kravis Center. My name is Mike Kirshner. Enough about me. I like messing with people's minds, and this is all about you. Are you ready to get started? Clean hand. Make an A-OK sign. Look at me. Look at the A-OK sign. Look back at me and take your hand and place it on your chin. Everybody, that's your cheek.
If you don't know where your chin is by now, we're in trouble. Let's have some fun in West Palm Beach. By the way, I'm from New York City. I love to come to the beach down here because I get to play with the beach ball. Whoever catches it, stand on up. All right. Stay right there. Oh, just so you can see, inside this box, which you can't see, I have a deck of cards. Will you do me a favor? Will you name any color? Well, red or black? Red or black? Tell me. A little bit louder. Okay. Perfect. Take that ball, toss it back. Stand up. Who's got it? Now, he said red. In a deck of cards, there's hearts and diamonds. Will you choose one?
Heart.
A heart. Perfect. Toss it back.
Stand
up right where you are. Oh, don't sit down. Don't sit down. Yes, hi there. Now, you said a heart. Will you name the blank of hearts? So you get to choose ace through king. You tell me. So you want to go with the ace of hearts. Is that correct? That's correct. Here we go. Let's see how we did. The ace of hearts. No, I'm joking. It's a joker. If I go through all these cards just like this, you're going to notice there is actually one card that's a little bit different from all the other cards. The Ace of Hearts. Let me show you. Inside this deck, there is one card that's different from all the other cards. Everybody, thank you very much. The Ace of Hearts. Now this is where it gets even crazy. Diamond Schmiemans. You're probably wondering why I have a briefcase over here. I'm glad you asked. Because inside here is the basketball. Thank you very much.
All right. Well, okay, Michael Horsley.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now that we have basketball, I think it's time to welcome two of the world famous Harlem Globetrotters to the stage. From Phoenix, Arizona, former University of Wyoming All-Star and team captain, Anthony Buckets Blakes. Now, this is why I got bullied in middle school. Not the best thrower. And from Brooklyn, New York, standing at 6'9" tall, former Hampton University All-Star, Dante Hammer Harrison.
Trick with this ball.
No trick.
No, come on, this cannot be real.
It's definitely real. They just dyed it red, white, and blue.
There's no way that you guys can have talent like that. You know what, there has to be something with, you must have like a problem. You must have a magnet or
Whoa.
No magnets.
I'm not sure. I think I've just seen a little bullying. What are you guys going to do about this? Dante, you just going to ignore that? What's going to happen?
We're going to smile.
We're going to smile.
That's what we're going to do.
Okay.
Speaking of smiling, let me share a little story with you all. I'm one of 10 children. I have 5 brothers and 4 sisters. So no one ever really bothered me as far as bullying goes because I had such a huge family until I got to high school. 2 older brothers graduated. I'm there by myself now. I still got a couple years to go. Love eating breakfast in the morning. I get up every morning, breakfast. So I get my tray, I go to school. When I get to school, I get my tray, get my breakfast. I go into the cafeteria and I was looking for a seat. And the only seat open in the cafeteria was at this table where I know this guy was known for being a bully. But I'm so happy to go lucky, I always got a smile on my face. I love to make friends. I didn't care, I sat down anyway. So he told me, you can't sit at my table. And I was like, it's not your table, we're going to the school. So I started eating. Well, he starts calling me names, telling jokes about me, and actually some of the jokes were funny. All the kids were laughing, so I started laughing. So he got upset with me that he couldn't hurt me with his words. So he gets up, gets around the table, stands in my face, I'm smiling, and I don't want to fight, so I'm walking away, I'm smiling, he's following me, I'm walking away smiling, he's following me. Little did he know, I was leading him right to my first class, which is my PE teacher, who was probably about hammer size. So he gets in trouble with the PE teacher, he gets in trouble with the principal, he gets in trouble with his parents, and he never bothered me again. But not only did I keep a smile on my face and didn't let him steal my joy, also I got a friend out of the deal. We ended up playing sports together. I played quarterback. I got a chance to pass to him because he was a wide receiver. I was a point guard. He was a shooting guard. I got a chance to pass to him in that aspect. And then track and field, we were on the 4x4 team. I got to pass the baton to him. So he had no choice but to work with me, and we're still friends to this day.
Thank you.
No problem.
All right, gentlemen, thank you very much. We're going to see more of the Harlem Globetrotters later. I think that these gentlemen do a lot of good. If you haven't heard about the Harlem Globetrotters, internationally famous, been around for what, 90 years? 89 years, the Harlem Globetrotters.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you, Dante.
Thank you,
Anthony. I think what we're going to do is deal with Michael the Magician a little bit later. But right now, what I want to do is tell you a little bit more about our program. Do the Right Thing is a project of the National Campaign to Stop Violence. This year, we have 34 middle schools participating in Palm Beach County at full participation, and that is a new record, which makes our program the largest in the country. Students in this program share their personal experience with violence in these essays, but the most important part of this program are the conversations that are inspired by these essays that take place in the classrooms. Simply stated, this program is a success because middle school classroom teachers care about the safety of their students and want them to enjoy a happy and successful life. Those teachers are in this room. They deserve our appreciation. Thank you. This is a voluntary program, and we are grateful for the principals here today who have encouraged their teachers to offer this challenge in the classroom. In order to participate in this recognition ceremony, the school must have at least 50% of their students actually take the challenge and write the essay. And as a bonus, every school here today will receive a $500 no strings attached check. These checks have been cut. They are waiting for you in the lobby. Please help me thank our sponsor, the William Pitt Foundation, for giving this. Now, I know that those teachers can put $500 to good use without anybody in the district administration telling them what to do with it, but among the honored guests in this room are representatives from the school district. They are honored because we have the highest academic officer, the chief academic officer with us, Mr. Keith Oswald, as well as area superintendents, Dr. Ian Saltzman and Mr. Rodney Montgomery, and elected members of your school board. Please welcome Karen Brill, Erica Whitfield, please stand, Marcia Andrews, and the chairman of the school board, Mr. Chuck Shaw. There they are. We are especially grateful to our superintendent, Wayne Gent, who has supported this program for all of the years that he has been here. Now, Wayne, as you know, is stepping down from Palm Beach County, and he's moving to Port St. Lucie. We're going to miss him, but we have asked Wayne Gent, if he would please, as one of our big supporters here, to say a good word to the students and maybe put a whisper a word of good word into the new incoming superintendent.
Well, Bill, I want to thank you for what you've done in the organization and for the sponsors. I especially want to thank our principals and our teachers for what they do in the classrooms every day. And to our students, when their students are able to put something down in writing, it helps them to really reduce some of their anxieties. It gives them a clear head and really helps them to almost problem solve themselves or maybe learn some things about themselves they didn't know before. And then they can come up with some solutions that we as adults really need to listen to our kids to find the solutions because we know that they're there. So we're very, very proud of this, and I will be leaving, but I'm sure and confident that my successor, Dr. Avosa, will totally embrace and endorse this program, and we'll keep it going on for years to come.
So thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Wayne. Appreciate that. Now, if your school is here today, you've had at least 50% of your students taking the challenge. But this year, 8 schools will also earn trophies for their significant commitment to the program. As your school name is called, will the principal please stand to receive your trophy? With 90% participation, Woodlands Middle with Jeffrey Issa, principal. With 93% participation, Watson B. Duncan Middle School, Philip D'Amico, president. With 94% participation, Coniston Middle School, Oscar Otero, principal. Also, with 94% participation, the only school that has participated in this program for all 9 years in a row, Palm Springs Middle School, Sandra Jinks, principal. But believe it or not, it gets better. With 96% of their student body participating, Western Pines Middle School, Robert Hatcher. Robert Hatcher, thank you, Mr. Hatcher, whose daughter happens to be one of the candidates this year. Now, with 98% participation, Osceola Creek Middle, Nicole Day, principal. Thank you, Osceola Creek. Also with 98% participation, Polo Park Middle School, Ann Clark, principal. Thank you, Ann Clark. There she is, Ann Clark. Now, incredible as it may seem, with 99.9% participation in their school, the number one school, Eagles Landing Middle School, Cynthia Chipata, president. Thank you, Eagles Landing, for your commitment to do something about violence. Do the Right Thing is in its 9th year here in Palm Beach County. It's in its 20th year nationwide. It involves some of the largest school districts in the country. The principal sponsor every year here in Palm Beach County has been the Florida Crystals Corporation. My friend, Pepe Fanjul Jr., whose family is the founder of that company, is the organizer of this campaign. He and I have worked closely on this project with the hope of reducing youth violence. He could not be with us today because he's working out of state, but he was able to record this message for you.
Hi, my name is Pepe Fanjul Jr. Although I can't be with you in person today, I want to thank my friend Bill Bone for working on this project. Florida Crystals is proud to be the sponsor of Do the Right Thing in Palm Beach County. Florida Crystals was founded by my family over 50 years ago when they settled in this area when they came over from Cuba. Today, the company produces sugar in 8 countries and employs 25,000 people around the world. And we are the largest producer of natural and organic sugar. Although we are a worldwide corporation, our headquarters and our roots are here in Palm Beach County. My wife and I and my coworkers have read many of your essays and think that you are all so courageous to write about this in such a personal way. We love to be surrounded by bright and compassionate people like you who care about this problem. Our goal is to stop the violence, and your ideas will help us do that.
Everyone in this room is a guest of Florida Crystals. Representing the company today is their vice president and corporate spokesman, Mr. Gaston Contens. Mr. Contens, will you please stand so we can all thank Florida Crystals for sponsoring this program. Thank you, Gaston. Writing and collecting these essays is a big job. And every essay is read by teachers and the school officials, who put them together to decide who's going to be the top 10. And finally, we have members of the community who have a special interest in the problem of violence that sit down and read all of your writings. In this regard, it is our policy that each submission be judged primarily on the message and not on the rules of grammar and punctuation. Dozens of community volunteers in the following organizations helped to read and rank all of the top 10 essays written by the students in this room. We thank Florida Crystals Corporation, the Palm Beach County Sheriff's Office, the School District Department of Curriculum under the direction of Diana Fetterman, and the Department of Secondary Curriculum and the Office of Student Intervention Services with the leadership of Kim Mazauskas and Kim Williams, the offices of Congressman Ted Deutsch, and the office of Congresswoman Lois Frankel, the Criminal Justice Commission, the office of our elected public defender, Carrie Howitt, and the office of our elected state attorney, the Honorable David Ehrenberg. And David Ehrenberg happened to be our first keynote speaker at the banquet that we held next door at the Cohen Pavilion about 8 years ago, and his office has been committed to this project, as you can see, as are all of the other criminal justice agencies in the community. But I've asked Dave Ehrenberg, because he's a longtime supporter, if he would just share with us in the audience a little bit about the experience of reading and ranking these essays.
Well, thank you, Bill, and good afternoon to everyone. You know, at the state attorney's office, we had 35 employees read a total of 313 essays. And we learn from you. I think we get more out of it than we give back, because we learn the depth of the problems facing young people today, whether it's bullying or domestic violence. We learn from all of you. And yet, our office sees the worst when it comes to violence in our community, especially when it involves young people. We had 4,200 arrests last year of young people. That's 2,400 individuals committing 4,200 crimes. Those are people who made very different choices than everyone in this room today. And so I want to thank you all for inspiring us all, because instead of choosing to fight violence with more violence, you fight it with the power of the pen and your mind, and those are much more powerful than violence. So thank you for all that you do, and I know in looking around this room, wow, that our country and our community are in such great shape for the future, because they will be led by all of you.
Thank you. Thank you, David Ehrenberg, our elected state attorney, and someday, some say, future governor of the state of Florida. Each of the reading and ranking organizations gets to send a representative to the final judging process, where the students who are selected and ranked by the different organizations are judged. So now I would like you to please join me, if you will, before we announce those finalists, in thanking the chair of the Boys Judging Committee, retired Circuit Court Judge Ron Alvarez, and the chair of the Girls Committee, Ms. Mary Simpsis. Please thank these judges. Thank you, Mary and Ron. Today, we have to say goodbye and a debt of thanks and gratitude to last year's ambassadors. Not only did they go to Washington and do a good job for us here in Palm Beach County, representing the best program in the nation, they went back to their schools and started initiatives on their own. So please thank for their service Kennedy Thomas and Michael Lesh. Thank you. Wait. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Kennedy. Now, every student here wrote from the heart, but 10 students shared experiences which were particularly compelling. These students were interviewed and chosen as the 10 finalists. And they're coming onto the stage now, and we're gonna introduce them. I want to ask them to step forward as their name is called. There's Scotty Brooker from Omni Middle School and Annie Wu from Congress Middle School. Please step up here. Thank you. Thank you, Annie and Scotty. Alphonse Alfred from Emerald Cove Middle School and Catherine Hook from Don Estridge Middle School. Thank you, Catherine. Michael Savalos from Okeehele Middle School and Sydney Levy from Boca Raton Middle School. Thank you, Sydney. Chad Aaron Walker from Western Pines Middle School and Zakiya Hobbs from JFK Middle School. And now, our 2015 ambassadors for Palm Beach County, Colby Guy from Watson B. Duncan Middle School and Maya Monson from Independence Middle School. Thank you, Maya. These are the faces and the voices of the top 10 students. Thank you to each of you. Thank you. Which way do they go? Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Colby. Thanks, guys. Thank you. Thanks again, Michael. Thanks, Scotty. Okay, here it is. This book is very important because it is probably, for most of you, the first time you have been published. It's pretty impressive, isn't it? Okay, these essays, together with the other ambassadors around the room, are published in this book so that we will hear about your words. But I want to make sure, has Lois come? Is she here? All right. Lois Frankel is a sitting member of Congress representing our district. This is the first time that a congresswoman has left the Capitol and come to honor each of you. And so I'd like you to welcome Lois Frankel, our congresswoman.
Well, thank you, Bill. This is so exciting. I am so happy to be here. And I just, first of all, I thank you and your organization, the sponsors. But most important is just congratulations to the parents, the teachers, and of course, the students. And in my mind, you are all winners. Let's give everybody a big hand. And really, with all that's going around in this country, I can't think of a more timely subject. And thank you all, students, for your good words. And I'm looking forward, Bill, to welcoming our two newest ambassadors to Washington, D.C. I'll see you there.
Thank you, Lois. Thank you. That's right. Our local ambassadors, together with ambassadors across the nation, will be visiting their congresswomen. And we appreciate that Lois Frankel cares enough about this project, not only to be here today, but her staff read and ranked your 314 works, which are presented in this book. Because the originals of the ambassadors will be placed into the Library of Congress, but we have found out this year for the first time we will be able to place your writings as well into the Library of Congress. This has been an important work. After this ceremony, everybody in this room is going to receive a copy of this book. It's an enormous and expensive task to publish a book, but our committee feels that it's necessary to do this because you have something to say, and we want not only your teachers and your principal and administration, but all of these other governmental agencies that you've heard about involved in the criminal justice system. We want everyone, as well as the people in this community, to be able to read what you say about the causes and the solutions of this problems from the students who experience it firsthand. So what I'd like to do now is acknowledge the fact that the entire cost of this book, and it is an enormous cost, is donated and contributed by our elected sheriff, the Honorable Rick Bradshaw, who is with us today. Please welcome your sheriff, the highest law enforcement officer in Palm Beach County.
Thank you. It certainly is an honor to be here today and be part of this program. First of all, congratulations to the teachers and the parents for having the courage and conviction to make sure that this conversation gets started. And to all the kids that are involved in this, thank you for having the courage to share your thoughts with us. One of the most dangerous problems we have, not only in this state, but this county, is the gangs. No one has fought harder against the gangs than your sheriff's office. But we cannot arrest our way out of this. They're after our kids every day. And if we don't learn what they think, and if they don't understand how to stay out of these gangs, we're going to lose this battle. So the message that we have to the gangs collectively is these are our kids, and you cannot have them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sheriff Bradshaw, for your commitment to keeping our children and our families safe. Now, we've honored the ambassadors and the finalists on this stage, but now you get to see and hear their voices. The video you're about to see was actually produced by students in middle and high schools in Palm Beach County. This was created to tell their story.
I think the Do the Right Thing program is great because it helps the youth explore youth violence and its effects. When I write about youth violence, I feel somewhat personal because I've had a bit of experience with it.
Like, it's like socially harder for me to like fit in with everybody having autism, and like it, sometimes I get nervous talking to people, that's like right now with my stuttering and all that.
In my essay, when I said that I was molested, that was something that I obviously didn't really want to go into detail. I felt disgusted with myself, so I just kind of laid there crying. I couldn't do anything. And I mean, that is basically something that has taken a big toll on my life.
As an Asian, I experienced a lot of stereotypes. So that's sort of like negative, because it's like, oh, you're good at math, do my homework. And I just don't really feel very good about that. And then like, with stereotyping, it's very negative to the person because they expect so much out of you because of your race and color, your skin. And it just really affects me. Like, sometimes I'll try and point out to certain people, like, hey, you probably shouldn't be stereotyping because not all Asians are smart. They're not all like super good at math or anything, and not all of them are all about education and stuff.
All we heard were gunshots. And I ran, and I found that was my boy on the floor. And he was just bleeding. He was just on the floor crying. He was like, bro, I'm finna die. I told him, don't say that. And 3 days later, they called, say he's dead.
People will call me a filthy Jew, and it made me feel bad about myself.
I honestly wanted to kill myself so bad, because I thought it was never going to get better. And it's just, I just look back and I'm thinking, like, why would I ever feel like doing that? And thinking, I remember how low I felt and how I thought like it was never going to get better. So I don't want to cry.
Do the right thing. This year, over 27,000 students in Palm Beach County took the challenge to express their thoughts and feelings. These 10 finalists personally experienced violence that changed their lives. Their stories include stereotyping, racism, death, bullying, mental abuse, and physical harm. Oftentimes, we think of youth violence as just physical, but the scars of bullying and emotional abuse can last a lifetime. Do the Right Thing is not a competition. Students are challenged to examine the impact of violence in their lives through classroom discussions and a written response to these three simple questions. How has violence affected your life? What causes youth violence? What can you do about it? We celebrate all the teachers, students, parents, and supporters of Do the Right Thing. We honor the ambassadors of our district, one girl and one boy, who will visit Washington, D.C. this summer and join students from across America in the national recognition events. The film you are watching was created by the students of the West Palm Beach Youth Empowerment Center to display the incredible strength of these 10 students. By sharing their stories, they rise above individual challenges and inspire us to change.
I've been bullied ever since I was in second grade and tormented up until seventh.
My dad or whoever was there, my dad or my grandmother, they would beat me with a belt. It was traumatizing. And it caused autoimmune disease called alopecia, which makes your hair fall out.
When I was a child, I would watch my mother get beaten basically every day. It made me a very violent person myself, and it made me hate most adult men at the time, and I hated anyone that she brought into the house, and it threw me off. It made me a very bad person.
When I was in second grade, when I got glasses, a lot of people laughed at me and they called me gay and retarded, and they tried to beat me up and all that every day when I went on the bus, so when I got in the classroom. It made me feel really bad about myself, and there was nobody who tried to stand up for me. And even when I told the principal and all that, nobody did anything.
I'd like people to know who have heard my story that there is a way to get through this through perseverance.
We have to substitute love, caring, and compassion instead of violence.
Everyone's different in their own amazing way, and I mean by that is because they have all their own different personalities and whatever else. And it would be really boring if everybody else had like the same personality, like the same thing, looked the same way. And it's all amazing that we all had our different qualities that make ourselves who we are.
Am I really that different than you? Is being different a crime or something we should embrace in each other?
Even though my mother went to jail and my father went to jail, but at different times, it's shown me that she came from jail and she became a totally different person, showing us that it's not right to be violent. You can handle things better.
The saying, sticks and stones may break your bones, it's not true. Words do hurt.
I can stop youth violence by becoming a positive role model to kids younger than I am.
Is there a true story in your life that needs to be told? Everyone can make a difference. Everyone can do the right thing.
I've been through a bunch, and looking at the person I am today, I hope that people will look at me and just get a feeling of, she did it, so can I. It is incredible to believe. It is incredible to believe and understand that the content as well as the production of that video were the students in this room, middle school and high school students, who have felt the pain of violence. The students of the Youth Empowerment Center who produced this video, they're sitting with us among the room. Thank you. Of the Palm Beach Film Institute. And now,
the person that sits next to me in class is afraid. She is afraid to talk, afraid to speak up, and afraid to fight back. A boy at lunch bullies her for money. Her name is Caroline. That boy, he has the same issue. He is afraid to talk, afraid to speak up, and afraid to fight back. I see the bruises. I see the scars. I also see the tears. Someone bullies him too. His name is Jason. Then there's the boy on the bus. In class, he laughs, he jokes, he plays. On the bus ride home, he cries. The tears he tries to calm fears. He too is afraid to talk, afraid to speak up, and afraid to fight back. His name is Christian. The girl in science class is always getting made fun of. They call her ugly, they call her poor. Every time she walks to class, she stares at the floor. She too is afraid to talk, afraid to speak up, and afraid to fight back. Her name is Sasha. Caroline, Jason, Christian, and Sasha, they are all my friends. And they have all been bullied by classmates, by parents, and some whom they once called friend. When the moon rises and I'm alone in my room, I often think of my friends and the pain they must feel. I often try to think of ways in which they can heal. And that's when it hit me. They are all too afraid to talk, too afraid to speak up, and too afraid to fight back. Bullying someone is cruel, and the effects can last a lifetime. If they are too scared to speak up, I will be the one to shine. The one to shine a light on their pain, their tears, their hurt. We all need to take a stand against what is wrong. Gone are the days when Jason's body showed the signs of torture. Gone are the days when Christian dreads his bus ride home, and gone are the days that Sasha is tormented and ridiculed. Now, when I sit next to Caroline in class, she is happy. When Jason's in the hall, he's not bullying, he is protecting. And when Christian is on his bus ride home, there are no more tears, and Sasha can walk to class with her head held high. They no longer have to wear a fake smile to hide their pain. Every time you choose to do the right thing, you are creating a smile and saving a life. Don't be afraid to talk, afraid to speak up, or afraid to fight back. Fight back.
I was 4 years old, and we were coming home from church on a Sunday afternoon. That was when we received the phone call that Aunt Julie died. We didn't know what she had died from. We were very sad because she was my mom's sister. We drove 10 hours to Charleston, South Carolina, and another 2 hours from Charleston to the funeral home. All of my 11 first cousins came out to the funeral that day. While at the funeral, Mom told the cousins that Aunt Julie died of a heart attack. But I knew that was false. And so I told Mom at the funeral home that it wasn't a heart attack. Even though I was 4 years old, I had this sense or instinct that she did not die from a heart attack. I knew she was murdered. My first prediction was that she was shot. I could picture my aunt's house on a noose surrounded by police. Later, I found out that she was not shot. And that the person who killed her, or should I say people who killed her, were named Leslie, her daughter Amanda, and her daughter's boyfriend, Josh. When Leslie was a teenager, she was a drug addict. She would spend all of her money on buying cigarettes, alcohol, and crack. Before long, she ran out of money and became bankrupt. When Leslie became older, she had a daughter. And the daughter became a drug addict just like her mother. And the daughter found a boyfriend who did the same. After borrowing so much money from other people, they didn't know what to do. So all three of them decided to steal from their neighbor, who was my godmother, Aunt Julie. Aunt Julie had already decided to move to another place, but before she could, Leslie, her daughter, and her boyfriend went into her home, broke a crock pot lid made of glass, and took the shards and stabbed her. Then they took her money and ran.
Teachers have told me you're having a hard time concentrating in class. I also know that you were called to testify on your father's behalf in an attempted robbery case. Okay? I can imagine how difficult and how distracting that might be for you. Okay? Can you tell me what happened that night? You see, Matthew, just because you told the courts this 3 months ago doesn't mean you can just forget about it. This is just between us. You're safe here.
My dad was, he was loading his luggage into his rental. Shiny baby blue 2013 Ford Mustang. He was just getting his last bag in the trunk when this other car skyrocketed down the street.
And where were you when this was happening?
I'm safe. I'm in my room watching WrestleMania.
What happens next?
I start to hear these screams. Loud screams coming from outside.
Do you get a chance to see who's screaming?
I tiptoe over to the window, and I'm looking out the blinds so that nobody could see me. And I see these three guys surrounding my dad.
Were they threatening him physically? It's okay, okay?
They got a gun down his throat.
Okay, Matthew, and then?
You ever seen leaves in the middle of autumn shaking? That's me.
Of course.
So I grabbed the phone to call 911. Except I dropped it on the way to my ear. Finally, I get the phone in my ear, and I felt like I waited forever. Finally, I tell them my address.
And what were you feeling?
In my head, I'm telling myself, everything's gonna be okay, that my dad's gonna survive.
And he did, right? Such an amazing recovery. So what happens with him and the three guys?
I hear this car alarm go off across the street. Beep, beep, beep. So I look out the window again to see whose car it is. And I see these three guys run back to their car and they take off.
Does that tell you anything about them?
Yeah. I thought that they were monsters. But they weren't monsters at all, they were chickens. They were big chickens.
Left and right,
across my face,
across my legs.
Voices in my head.
can't be a size zero.
Or he doesn't have the new shoe.
His mother is working three jobs to pay the rent.
The girl eats, but throws up because she feels fat.
And there are others.
There are others? For what?
To feel good.
Shot dead February 26, 2012. George Zimmerman, the killer, pleaded self-defense in front of a Florida jury and was found not guilty. Trayvon Martin was walking home from the store with an Arizona tea and a bag of Skittles, trying to make it home in time for the Heat game. This could have been me. What if I looked like an alleged thief? Is it because of the color of my skin that I have to live in fear of being accused a killer, a drug dealer, or a thief? Even worse, what if I am shot dead for being suspect to any of these things? Tamir Rice was recently shot for having a pellet gun at the park. This boy is the same age as me, and I have played with pellet guns at the park. What if this were me? This scares me. I want to write to these families. What are the right words?
I get made fun of for the way that I speak and look. People laugh at me for the amount of pimples that I have on any given day. I used to wear a yarmulke, which is a head covering that Jewish men wear to remind them of the presence of God. I got bullied so much that I had to stop wearing these religious and cultural traditions. But believe me, if you stand up for yourself and you tell a parent or a guidance counselor, things will be all right. And at my school, there's even a bullying box. Because if I see anyone being bullied, I'll know how to help. Because I know what it feels like.
I'm the type of kid who has opinions about the world and wants them to be heard. But ever since I became interested in politics, especially in the Middle East, because that's where my parents were born, my mother has told me over and over, I have to be careful what I say. I didn't understand, so I asked her. She told me that some people in this world can be a bit... She didn't have the words at the time, but I know what she meant. Some people in this world can be a bit dangerous to talk to that way, because you never know how they're going to react. Every day, I want to yell, I am proud to be a Muslim. But I don't, because I never know who could be hearing me say that. You know, I also kind of find it funny that every time a Muslim person does something wrong, their religion is always mentioned. But when a non-Muslim person does something wrong, their religion isn't. And since this happens every single time someone does something wrong, I always pray that the person isn't Muslim. One day, I hope the news reporters get their facts straight.
My mom, she was a newspaper reporter for many years, so acts of violence against journalists hit home, and freedom of speech is highly regarded in my household. A lot of my mom's friends are still journalists today. And it scares me to think that, these people might be subjected to the same type of violence. Recently in the Middle East, terrorists have killed journalists. Terrorists want to keep people silent. And if the journalists are scared to do their job, which is express opinions, then no one knows anything. And if no one knows anything, then those people in power can take control. Just this past week in Paris, France, 12 people were killed in a newspaper for writing and drawing political cartoons. In my language arts class, I have to write about editorials, and I have to write about political cartoons. So if I'm doing the same thing that these people were killed for, am I targeted too? This makes me feel worried and nervous. My mom told me that, my mom and my dad decided to get pregnant with me after September 11, 2001, because they needed some kind of hope in this world. So, in a sense, my whole life has been a response to terrorism. But in December of last year, somebody took it way too far. Starting December 18th, I was getting the sickest, cruelest, anonymous messages on a social media website named ask.fm. They said I was worthless, retarded, gay, and worst of all, they said they would murder me if I didn't commit suicide by Christmas. The slurs kept building and building. The pain was destroying me inside, and I kept it that way. Until a week later, when I attempted to suffocate myself with the lanyard attached to my student ID badge in front of my entire fifth period civics class. The whole class was worried, and the teacher sent me to the office to talk to the school police officer and guidance counselor. It took me half an hour to tell them why I wanted to kill myself, and once they found out, they called my mother. She was so shocked when she found out, she drove up to the school with no hesitation. I got many calls from my family up there Long Island, and they were all shocked. At that moment, I realized that I should have listened to one devious person's sinful words and threats and end my life and break the hearts of my friends and family. I'm the writer. I'm in charge of the story of Kobe Guy. And this is the happy ending.
You see, this is what victims of bullying face. They're covered with scars of lots of pain. And no matter how much you try to apologize or fix it, there will always be those scars. Just like the creases in the piece of paper that you try to fix, but never go away.
Hey, the only violence I've ever seen in my life is when my neighbor harasses her little chihuahua and she gets away with it.
Although I have not personally experienced violence in my life, it's affected my life in so many ways. Every day, my son and daughter go to school, and they have to lug hefty backpacks across rows and rows of empty lockers. When they have to use the restroom, they have to go all the way to the front office to get a key to unlock the bathroom door. They have a school campus police officer in case someone tries to break in, or a fight breaks out, or a student brings a gun to school. Have you heard of Code Red drills that prepare teachers and students in case an act of violence happens on campus? 20 years ago, none of these safeguards were in place. Violence has changed the way that we do school. And for Ryan and Alyssa, this is normal.
To whom it may concern, for the last 3 years, I have been giving the same writing prompt. Do the right thing. So I ask myself, why am I writing about the same thing again? The last 2 years, I wrote about how violence is everywhere, how it's in our video games, on the internet, in all the movies. But this year, I want to write about how we can fight violence. I suggest that we do random searches in all schools, all lockers, even bring canine dogs to sniff out for drugs. I value my life more than my rights at school. I wouldn't feel like anyone's infringing on my rights. My mom, she looks at everything that my sister and I do at home. What we read online, what we're reading, what we're watching. I don't feel like she's infringing on my rights. I feel like she's protecting me. Sincerely, Ryan Patrick Galbraith.
Quick movements. Hot rooms, blurred surroundings, girls. Women are dragged to their doom by the men that have took them, touched them, and drug them until motionless. I can't walk the streets at night. I have to confirm that my clothes aren't too tight. My mom and dad say the world is crazy and it's growing. No better progress. My father, he gets shaky each time we leave his sight. He believes we're not strong enough to fight. He's afraid they'll put a bullet to our heads or force us to spread our legs. And I've heard from my mother that men are sick when it comes to temptation. Their hearts are hard as brick. This business of theirs is called trafficking. I'm told of young girls and boys and men and women are sold. They showcase the victims' bodies for their pleasure, of their dark, twisted souls. They give them barely any clothes. They stuff them in these thick air areas filled with the echoes of their own hysteria. Their innocence drained from their now dangerous life. Fears of being cut with a knife or shoved into a glass case and stared down by men who desire to buy them no matter how proud. But there is hope. They feel that they're on the end of their rope, but I will create organizations and find every child being trafficked across the nation. They'll feel the pain of their beatings no more, and I'll mend every heart they tore. And for those that have attacked, they will be tracked and taken to where they belong.
So, does it seem weird that as a 14-year-old girl, I am so glad my father is in prison? Well, if so, I say that it's even weirder to have your father protest of going to jail on the night he is arrested by saying, and I quote, "I can't go to jail because I have to watch the World Cup." Now there's a dad a girl could be proud of.
Joshua Alcorn has been hit by a truck.
send the ambulance to the Alcon residence thinking that this was just another accident. They were wrong. The ambulance were wrong. The dispatchers were wrong. We were wrong. Leela Alcorn died December 28, 2014. Leela Alcorn was a victim of her parents' bullying. Leela Alcorn was a transgender female. Leela Alcorn was a victim of bullying.
And the cause of it, her parents' beliefs. They believed it was a sin and brought shame to Leela when she came out as transgender at 14. They told her it was just a phase and that she would grow out of it. And instead of getting her the transition treatment she wanted, at 16 they sent her to conversion therapy.
She stated later in her suicide note that she felt hopeless, that she was just going to look like a man in drag for the rest of her life.
She went through so much just to be able to love herself. And she was shot down and rejected by the people who were supposed to have her back, no matter what, because they're family. All she wanted was to be accepted. And it's so sad that she's not here today to see everyone that supports her, loves her, and wishes she were alive today.
Leela, now you can rest in peace.
Thank you.
hear it for the Do the Right Thing Ensemble. Please think about what you just saw, these words enacted on this stage and the voices, and remember, none of this was made up. This is not some adult in a classroom somewhere teaching a class. These are the words, the feelings, and the experiences of people who are in this room. And I know it's hard, because not all of it is something you can understand or agree with as an adult and as a parent. But I do have a message, if you will, for the students in this room. You are not alone. You are part of something important. Look around you. All 314 students in this room are now officially ambassadors for peace and kindness at your school and in your community. And though Colby and Maya will be representing you in Washington, this afternoon we honor each of you for expressing your thoughts, experiences, and the solutions. When you leave here today, you have the power to unchain the world. You are the authors of the real life stories to come. Do the right thing and strive to give every story a happy ending. And now, before we finish, let's bring back on Buckets Blakes and Hammer Harrison to share the joy with us one more time. Gentlemen, are you still in the house? We're just about done. Here we are. There they go.
Earlier, I spoke about not letting a bully steal my joy and keeping a smile on my face and walking away. So now, I want to spread a little joy by doing a trick with someone in the crowd. I signed insurance waivers, so I'm about to jump off of it. How about this little girl right here? Can you stand up and put one finger up? You, yeah, you. No. I'm not gonna hit you, I promise. Give her a big hand. All right, I'm gonna take the steps this time. Now, I think we might have one more cool trick.
One more?
Right, one more?
Okay.
Here we go.
But, what? Let me see that.
Okay, here we go. Let's see how this works.
Through the leg.
You know, I have to tell you, you guys are awesome. Let's give them a big round of applause. After listening to these compelling stories from the students and from you guys, I like to apologize for taking your wristband. And I want to give it back to you.
Okay.
But I want to get an autograph first. Can I get an autograph?
Sure.
Yeah, not from you. Oh. I think there's somebody over here that I'd like to get an autograph from. Let's see. Oh, these are steep. Oh, let's see. Hi. What's your name? That's correct. Shelby, will you help me out? Oh, you don't have to get up. You can stay right there. Unless you want to get up. Will you do me a favor? Will you autograph this for me? It's open. Thank you very much. I'll take this back. Thank you. Let's give her a big round of applause. I figured, really, the true stars of the show are the people in the audience. Although, you're pretty good as well.
Well, thank you.
And, you know what? Would you be so kind? Can I have your autograph also?
Okay.
Sweet.
And we're gonna try to do something a little strange using the wristband. If I take the wristband and I go like this, I give a little tap, that's when it disappears.
Okay.
It's in your shoe.
Oh.
Yeah, that'd be really cool. I have an idea. Let's figure out a good way to get it back.
Okay.
Don't worry, I'm not pulling out another basketball from this. I need a deck of cards. I want it so everybody can see this. Is this all right? In the back? No, I'm joking. That's a big deck of cards.
Big money.
All right. 52 cards means 52 possibilities. Will you do me a favor? Will you take one of those cards, but don't show it to anybody. Just look at one and hold it close to you. Good?
Let me see.
Don't show it to him. And you know what? I'm gonna need everybody. Everyone just kind of yell out a letter. From A to Z, yell out a letter. Come on. F, all right. Put your hand. Put a big F on there. F for fun. Right?
Fantastic.
Just out of curiosity, what card did you choose? Let me see. What's the number on it?
It's a 4.
Let me see. A 4. So we have a 4 and we have an F.
F. 4.
A 4 F. F 4.
For Frank.
For Frank or for fun?
For fun.
Oh, you know what? Maybe it's a seat. Maybe it's a seat number.
Is it up there?
Is there a seat number of F4?
There's an exit.
I had someone. Will you stand up right where you are? And what's your name?
Holly.
Holly, underneath your seat, taped to the bottom of your seat, is an envelope. Will you bring up the envelope, please? Take your time. Hurry up. We have all day. Bring it up. Let's go. Oh, actually, to be fair, make it easier. Pass it down. Wait. Give it to her. No, behind you, the one that signed it.
Come on.
Perfect. Down. Hey, let's give them both a big round of applause. Thank you. Hey. No, come over here. Yeah. Oh, you didn't get away that easy. Thank you, by the way. What's your name again? Let's give Shelby a big round of applause. Come up the stairs. Jump.
I thought Shelby had a vertical. She's gonna jump up here.
I'll take the card. Shelby. Shelby, if you don't mind, step right over here into my office. And will you open up the envelope, please? Oh! There's a box! Let's see. Inside the box, oh, by the way, guarded with a rubber band, is something in there. Can you see that?
Yes.
What is that? What is it? It has a signature on it. And let's give her a big round of applause. Is that your signature? Thank you very much. Let's give her a big round of applause. Right.
Was it really your signature?
All right. Are you going to give that to me?
I'm going to hold on to it. Now.
Is that it?
That's it.
All right.
Thank you very much.
I think we've just been bullied and magicked, and I appreciate it. Thank you, guys. Good. Thank you, Buckets.
Thank you, Michael. Much.
Thank you, Dante. Okay, before we conclude this afternoon's show, I want to recognize a little housekeeping matters. We're just about out of here. Have you had a good time today? Yeah. Is it worthy? Were you glad you wrote those? You glad you did that writing assignment now? Or you weren't so excited about it at the time, were you? Okay, I want to thank the Palm Beach Post. Palm Beach Post is our media sponsor, and they're going to be publishing on their online site your writings. So if you're not reading the Palm Beach Post, you need to go out and subscribe now. I also want to thank TEN, the Education Network, especially Dave McKinley and Rick Hammond, because they have filmed the entire show today, and they're going to be broadcasting it
again on the Education Network. So go to their website to find out the date and the time if you want to see what's happened and see that you're recognized out there. I also want to thank a very special friend today that I want to acknowledge and recognize. You saw her on the stage earlier, and that's a woman who's been worked in many departments at the school district, and she's helped us a lot. She is retiring this year, and that is Kim Williams. Where is she? Kim is in the audience. I want to thank you. Where are you, Kim? Please stand. Thank you for your contributions to this. There she is over there. Thank you, Kim. We have a little blue bag for you from Tiffany's. I also want to thank the coordinator of this program. He's a man whose full-time job is an investigator for my law firm, but his other job is to be the coordinator of this, and many of you worked with him, and his name is Brian Labadee. Anyone who's worked with Brian knows that he is a terrific guy. I want to thank you. Okay, thank you, Brian. All right, that's about it. And what I'd like to do for you also is remind you that the Harlem Globetrotters, the magician, are going to be out in the lobby, as well as the actors, because truly, all the acting was done by the words you wrote in those books. If one of those actors portrayed your work, would you go up and tell them, because they really want to meet you? Thank you for coming again this year. Welcome back. Thank you again, teachers, and thank you, principals. It's been a great day.